Hey y'all, this is Dr. Carmen Corder with thedoctornurse.com, and in this video I want to talk a little bit about the care of burn patients. Now I just posted a complete blog post going over exactly what I'm going to talk about in this video, because I know some of y'all are real visual, some are more auditory, so you can use the blog post along with this video, along with the quick reference guide that is posted on thedoctornurse.com under the mini patho course. So let's go ahead and just dive in and start talking about the care of these very complex patients. Now, there are different phases of care for burn victims. There is the emergent phase where the healthcare providers arrive on the scene where the burn actually took place. Then there is the time when the patient is transported to the local emergency department, and then their care throughout their hospital stay or transfer to a burn center, and then possibly even long-term care for severely burned patients. But the two stages that I'm going to talk about in this video, both are part of what we call the resuscitative phase, and I'm going to talk about the pre-hospital and the hospital resuscitative phase of the care of burn patients. So, with the care of burn patients, obviously it's very, very complex. These patients have so many potential complications, so many potential injuries. They can go into burn shock. So the care that is provided to these patients in the immediate, you know, first few hours after that initial burn injury is absolutely paramount to how these patients are going to, if they're going to survive, and to their outcomes. So the number one first priority, if you arrive on the scene of a patient that has suffered a burn, is to stop that burning process, okay? I explain it like this to my students. If you had a patient and that patient had a blood sugar of 350 and you needed to give them a subcutaneous injection of some insulin, but that patient was laying on the railroad track, what would you do first? Take them off the railroad track or give them the insulin on the railroad track? You would remove them from the railroad track. So that is the first priority with our burn patients, because the burn is what is causing the injury. So we've got to stop that burning process, and that's going to look a little bit different depending on what type of burn it is. For thermal burns, you're going to extinguish the flames, maybe smother them with a blanket, use water. One thing that you never do is use ice to put out a burn. That can cause significant tissue damage to the patient. If it is a chemical burn, if there are chemicals on the patient, powders, things like that, then the clothing needs to be removed immediately, because the burning is going to continue as long as that chemical is in contact with the patient's skin. So all clothing removed. The patient is then doused with water for chemical burns. And with chemicals, you're going to have to be wearing personal protective equipment to protect yourself from coming into contact with that chemical, because if you get burned, then you're going to be no good to your patient. If it's an electrical burn, obviously the patient needs to be removed from the electrical source while protecting yourself as the rescuer. If the patient is scalded by, like, say, hot tar or asphalt or something like that, and they have clothing that is stuck to them, do not try to remove that clothing, okay? Because what you're going to do is probably remove skin and tissue with that. All right, so that's just kind of the different ways that you would stop the burning process, but that is, in a nutshell, the number one. Nothing else needs to be done before the burning process is completely stopped. No other assessments, no other interventions. Once that is complete, we have stopped the burning process, we've stopped further injury from occurring to the patient, we're going to move on to the next most logical step, which is we're going to assess the airway. Now, for patients who have significant facial burns or facial injuries, probably going to go ahead and intubate prophylactically, because we know that there is a great potential for airway edema and that airway closing up. So once you assess that the airway is patent, they've been intubated, or an oral airway has been put into place, whatever needs to be done to keep that airway patent, then we're going to address breathing with oxygen. So if you have someone that's on the scene and you're on the scene with a patient that's just been burned, you're going to give them 100% humidified oxygen, either through the ET tube or 100% non-rebreather. That's what's going to be used at the scene for patients with any type of inhalation, smoke inhalation injury, any evidence that they have some airway edema or that airway is trying to close up on them. We're going to give them 100% oxygen. Next, we will address circulation. Yes, circulation is absolutely addressed at the scene of the burn. So you're going to remove any restrictive clothing, right? So jewelry, clothing that is restricting the patient from perfusing or breathing, all that needs to be removed. We're going to start IVs, preferably two large IVs, like 18 or even 16 gauge IVs. And we're going to start IV fluids. LR, or lactated ringers, is going to be the fluid of choice for burn patients. After all that is complete, now remember, we're still at the scene, then a very rapid head-to-toe assessment needs to be completed, just to assess for any other life-threatening injuries that you will need to explain to the healthcare providers that accept the patient once they arrive to the hospital. So a rapid head-to-toe assessment, you know, assess their neurological status, assess for any other life-threatening injuries, assess their extremities for any circumferential burns, because that's going to impede circulation, and get a brief history from the patient. This is the time period where they're most likely to be awake and alert and able to answer your questions, because once we get them to the hospital, then they're probably going to start putting them to sleep, start giving them sedatives, and, you know, possibly doing surgeries and things like that. So this is the best opportunity to get a very quick history from the patient. What happened? What type of burn? What led to the burn? What chemicals were involved? Also, any kind of medical history that you can get from your patient. Are they allergic to any medications? Are they allergic to anything else? What medications do they take? What diseases do they have that could complicate anesthesia? Things like that. Things that are very, very pertinent to the continuum of care when they make it to the hospital. Those things need to be assessed, if at all possible, at the scene. Now, one thing I didn't mention is you've got to pay attention to if the patient needs cervical spine precautions or not before you transport the patient. If they have fallen from a building or something like that, then they're going to need cervical spine stabilization, and they're going to be needed to be loaded onto a backboard before we transport them. Another reason for starting the IVs is, if at all possible, we would like to give these patients some narcotic pain medicine, because the transport process is likely to be very painful for them. All right, so that's a basic overview of what's going to happen at the scene. Now we're at the hospital. Your ABCs are continuing to be assessed, but now we have more advanced equipment, better equipment that we can assess the patient with. So for patients that were not intubated at the scene, we're going to assess them again. Is there any new stridor? Is there any new wheezing? Is there any new evidence of airway edema? We're going to go ahead and intubate. For patients that were intubated at the scene, the placement of the ET tube needs to be checked and verified by an X-ray. We need to secure that ET tube. That ET tube has to be secured very, very, very well. That is very important, because if that patient is accidentally extubated for any reason, then imagine how hard it could be to reintubate that patient if that if that airway edema continues to worsen because they've had an inhalation injury. Now, as we are securing the ET tube, we're also taking care to make sure that we're not tying those ties around the patient's ears or anything that has had significant burn injury. We don't want to cause more tissue injury with what we use to secure the ET tube with, okay? All right, we can also use a bronch. We can use a fiber optic bronchoscope to go down and assess for, you know, any airway injury that we weren't able to assess at the scene. So lots more access to equipment to help us better treat this patient and better figure out what's going on with the patient. Next, we're going to assess breathing. Obviously, we're going to listen to breath sounds. We're going to look at the quality of their respirations. We're going to look at the sputum. Is it, you know, tarry? Is it bloody? Are they coughing up, you know, black soot? Is there black soot around their mouth or something like that? Chest wall excursion. Have they had any type of, you know, like flail chest? Have they had an injury where they had a car accident or they fell or something? We need to assess for that. ABGs and carboxyhemoglobin levels will be assessed if there was, say, cyanide or carbon monoxide poisoning involved. And if there was exposure to cyanide or carbon monoxide, then the patient needs 100% oxygen. That will reverse those types of poisonings. Again, I've talked about giving oxygen. So that's kind of an overview of what we'll do about breathing. Also, things like albuterol, medications, now that we have access to, now that we're at the hospital, can be given to assist with airway inflammation and opening up those airways for the patient to get that oxygen. Next, we will address circulation again. Now, here is where we will do a estimation of the total body surface area that has been burned using the rule of nines. I suggest you look up a good picture. There's tons of pictures on Pinterest that show you the percentage that each body part counts for. But using the rule of nines is a good way for us to estimate the total body surface area that's been burned. And that's another thing that we need to take into account, because if patients have a large percentage of their body that's been burned, they're going to need to go to a special burn center. So if they have 20% or greater total body surface area burn, if they have full thickness burns, if they have burns in certain areas of the body, they're going to have to go to a burn center, because those types of burns require very specialized care. Once we have estimated the total body surface area, we're then going to use the Parkland formula to estimate how much fluid this patient is going to need. And our burn patients need a lot of fluid because of capillary permeability. The capillaries have been damaged by the burn, so there's going to be a lot of fluid leaking out of the intravascular space. So these patients, if fluid is not replaced in adequate amounts, they're going to go into burn shock. So the Parkland formula is pretty easy. You have to know your patient's weight in kilograms. And I think program to program, this number right here, this 4, is going to vary a little bit. So be sure and know what your program goes by when calculating the Parkland formula. But using the Parkland formula, you're going to take 4 and multiply times the patient's weight in kilograms, multiply that times the total body surface area. And it's real easy if they, let's say they have 25% total body surface area burned and they weigh 100 kilograms, it's going to be simply 4 times 100 times 25. I think I said 25%. So it's not 0.25 like you would think, but it's literally the number. So if it's a 25% total body surface area burned, then the number you're going to use here in the Parkland formula is 25. And you're going to get a very large looking number for fluid volume replacement, like, you know, 15,000 milliliters. But that's what they need. They need a lot of fluid. And now going by the Parkland formula, you're going to give that, and the Parkland formula is for the first 24 hours. So of that, however much, if you come up with 15,000, they need 15,000 cc's of fluid replacement, then you're going to give that half of it in the first 16 hours, and then the remaining half over the last 8 hours. And so that's how the Parkland formula works. Now, how do we know that fluid replacement is adequate? Well, we're going to have to put in a Foley, and we're going to titrate that fluid to ensure that the patient has at least 30 to 50 milliliters of urine output per hour. If their urine output is much lower than that, then fluid volume replacement is not adequate. All right, so this is just a quick overview of the pre-hospital and the emergency department care for our burn patients. There's so much more that we could talk about and go into depth about, which I'll probably do in future blog posts and future videos for you guys. But I hope this video has been helpful. Head to thedoctornurse.com, check out the blog post, check out the reference guide on care of burn patients under the mini patho course. Hit that subscribe button on my YouTube channel. Head over to thedoctornurse.com and subscribe to our mailing list. There's free stuff going out now every week to everybody that subscribes to our mailing list. And don't forget to check out our Facebook group, The Doctor Nurse, Helping Students Become Nurses. Join our Facebook group. Join 400 other of your peers and nurses and future nurses, where we learn and grow together and share knowledge. And I just want to thank you so much for watching my video, and I hope you got something out of it, and I hope to hear from you guys real soon.